planks.
Have some trouble with the solar, but
yeah. Dan and Mick are still looking for timbers to try and date all the buildings. The roof and walls of this barn certainly don't look medieval, but there may be bits inside that are.
Oh, it's dark in here, isn't it, Dan?
Yeah.
Does it look as if we might get anything out of these timbers?
We'll have a look.
I mean, is not a problem, Dan, that some of these timbers might have been reused? This one here looks got a rebate in it, for example. Is that likely to be a problem in dating the building?
Well, it won't date the building if it's reused. I mean, it would date where it's come out before.
Yeah.
Mick's also curious about the barn foundations. These massive blocks of stone look just like the ones in parts of the hall and gatehouse, so maybe they're part of a medieval building too. After nearly 2 days looking for clues, Beric thinks he's got enough dates for various bits of the medieval buildings to piece together the story of their construction.
Beric, you reckon this medieval hall was built twice, don't you? That it was built and then it collapsed and then it was built again?
Well, no, Tony. Actually, I don't any
longer. You told me before lunch.
Well, I've changed my mind. I've now got a theory that reconciles the contradictions in that.
Which is?
Well, Alan de Charlton started building it before he died. He died in the Black Death in 1349.
Yes.
The family's in disarray, not much happens. But eventually, perhaps 40, perhaps almost 50 years later, they pick it up again and they complete the job. They complete the job, finally, with putting on that fancy roof, bits of which we found in the other, in 1400.
That's incredibly vivid and incredibly plausible, but I know you. If you've just said that, you'll completely change your mind by first thing tomorrow.
I don't think so. I'm going to go and look at some of those detail points again tomorrow, just to convince myself, and then I'll convince you later tomorrow morning.
Dan hasn't had much luck with the roof timbers in the Great Hall, but the beams from the solar date from around 1470. Unless the building took 120 years to finish, they must be part of a later refurbished floor. As for the results from the barn, we'll have to wait till tomorrow.
Typical time team, we gave ourselves the task of dating this wonderful medieval building, and then we spend the whole day poking around in the rain, looking out at medieval pigsties and outside toilets.
Victorian pigsties, actually, Tony.
Well, that's even worse. I must say that Beric gets the Medal of Honour today, because at least he's come up with an interesting medieval theory. But Mick, what are we going to do tomorrow to try and knock it on, to try and establish more about the dating of this building?
Well, I've been lime-burning a lot as a day. And it looked great from the air, mind you, but I haven't had a chance to catch up with the rest of the developments yet.
Then that's not a great deal of help, is it? Carenza, how about you?
Well, I'm the one who's after the medieval loo and the drains, and we're still hopeful we will find them, but as yet, we need more work. But Phil's Trent's looking good.
I'm looking really, really positive. I mean, true, I've got yet another brick floor, but I'm pretty hopeful that when we get that up, we're going to get medieval deposits underneath.
Paul, what about in here?
Well, all the cleaning's showing up a lot of medieval architectural features, which Beric can have a good look at tomorrow, and I'm still hopeful we might get some medieval floor levels in here.
Great. I must say, all day, I've seen that big trench covered in those infuriating red bricks.
they're protecting it. They may be protecting our most important medieval deposits.
Yeah, well, let's hope they don't have to protect it tomorrow. Let's rip their damn things up. Tomorrow we will rip up the red bricks and hope there's something medieval underneath. See you after the break. Cheers.
Cheers.
Beginning of day three, and as you can see, we're all hard at work. Ian, why am I dressed like this?
You might well ask. We're going to be unloading the lime kiln, and the lime that's in there is still hot from last night, and it's also caustic, so it's very important that we wear protective clothing.
If we take the sheet of tin off the top,
with our first glance of what's happened overnight, what we're looking for are those that are very light in colour.
Like these here, look, which are much lighter.
And also feel nice and feel lighter in weight.
Well, these still feel very heavy, the top ones. Is this yellow a clue? Is it noticeably more yellow than the...
Yes, it is. It started off this very grey colour, and it's changed to a yellow, a dirty white.
Apparently it's called quicklime because the chemical reaction is so violent, which is why we need the goggles.
This is just water straight from the stream.
Oh, crikey, look at this, Tony. It's falling to bits, isn't it? Ooh.
Well, I'm glad Mick's impressed. It's hard to believe we're going to get lime mortar from this by the end of the day. In the inner courtyard, we've got one last chance to find the guard rogue foundations beneath these cobbles. And we've finally managed to rip up the brick floor of our Victorian shed. Phil!
Hey! Yeah!
I've got your watercolour. Why do you want this?
Well, we've got your bricks off for you.
Yes!
We've got another floor service. But I think that this floor is the one that the Reverend Williams would have seen when he painted this picture in 1789. Here, grab hold of that, Mick.
Oh, great. Yet another floor to dig through before we get to the medieval.
Look, we've got a culvert in there.
All right. So what sort of date are we thinking of for that, then? Or are you thinking of a date at all?
I think it's got to be medieval of some sort. The mortar is very, very similar to what goes on in the hall.
I mean, it doesn't look wide enough to have had a full wall to a good height. It perhaps had a timber-framed structure on the top, perhaps.
It certainly, in its later life, we can see how tall it was because of the imprint in the end wall of the hall there.
Yeah, you can actually see. We need a stick, Tony. Well, here we are. Makeshift stick. You see this white lime plaster on here?
Yeah.
Well, you see it stops
it
at a line
there,
that's...
It goes up
I see,
it's actually a V-shape.
And look here, Tony, is where the roof timbers went in.
There and there, look.
Yeah.
And we think it probably had a lean-to roof on here, look. Right down to there.
It's all still here, in bits and bobs on the side of the building.
There's a bit of me saying, why do we care? I mean, I can understand why we can get so excited about this big building here, but basically what we're looking at is a kind of pretty rough old cow
shed. it's what people have been doing on the site, Tony. You know, you can't draw lines around archaeology and say this bit is important because it's ever so old or it's a very high status building.
I mean, we may not be able to get any dating out the ground for this building, but if we can sort that one out and then we work out what the relationship of that one is with this one, even if the relationship's up there, it still might give us the clue. So, you know, they're all little clues that we've got to put together.
Are you convinced now?
Nearly.
We'd hoped to get more medieval remains in this trench than one drain and half a jug handle, but elsewhere in the main courtyard, we have found what we were looking for.
Of the cross range.
Can I ask you about the aureal? Because on the first day, one of the first questions we set ourselves was, can we date the aureal? Have we got anywhere on that?
Well, we've excavated its foundations and we found a massive stone raft which would have carried it. So we know it was there. We also know that that stone raft goes with the primary construction of the building.
So does that mean that we can date the aureal because its foundations are part of the first phase of the building?
Well, yes and no. We don't necessarily know it was constructed to full height. So they may not have got round to do the windows, the fenestration, for example.
It might have been part of this Black Death hiatus.
Absolutely.
So, can we hazard a guess at what it looked like? Presumably, all we can say is either or. It looked like one thing if it was with the first phase and another thing in the second
phase. That's right. We're going to present two options, and the two options are fairly straightforward. If it had been that early phase, then it'll be a small window, but much the same sort of style as that. These aureoles are quite young as ideas, and they just really mean a lobby that the Lord went through on his way up into his chamber. But if, however, it comes in that second phase, then we could expect a larger window in that more modern style. And that'll be a window that'll look something like that. Very much larger, very much grander.
And what does aureole mean?
Well, aureole seems to mean a building that stuck out a bit, like your ear.
Aureole,
yes. Yes.
Yesterday, when Mick and Mark argued about where to put the trench in front of the gatehouse, I thought they'd agreed to follow the line of the geophysics results. But this trench is nowhere near it.
Now, what's going on here, Mark? When we last talked about this trench, we were looking at geophysics over here, where we talked about putting a trench across there, and then we argued about this poor bloke's garden and the path. When I was up in the helicopter, you've dug it in an L shape.
Well, it seemed a good idea at the time, really. We argued we wanted to get the relationship from the medieval gatehouse through into whatever
anomaly
there might be.
Yeah, OK, well, we agreed that we might extend it a bit,
way. So I thought it would be easier to put the trench across the anomaly rather than along the anomaly, as you originally suggested.
But the anomaly's further over. If you look on the map, look, it doesn't start or further up. If you look at the geophysics, there's the door over there. There's the edge of what might be, we thought might be a moat. And then there's a gap, and then the anomaly starts over there where the pole is. John drew that anomaly in.
Yes, I drew that deliberately because this is in an area of confusion. You're in the middle of where the old field boundary is.
So it looks as if we've actually put the trench in, more or less between the two anomalies that we were looking for. We've